Gillian Flynn wrote a 2012 thriller called Gone Girl. It has sold 8 million copies worldwide. It follows Nick and Amy Dunn, a couple experiencing a marriage gone wrong. When Amy mysteriously goes missing on their fifth anniversary, Nick becomes a prime suspect in the investigation of her possible murder. It is now filmed by David Fincher. Here's the trailer for Gone Girl.
Nick Dunn, you're probably the most hated man in America right now. Did you kill your wife, Nick?
Everyone told us and told us marriage is hard work. Not for me and Nick.
As you all know, my wife, Amy Elliott Dunn, disappeared 3 days ago. I had nothing to do with the disappearance of my wife. I have nothing to hide.
Has Amy got friends we can talk to?
No, not really.
You don't know if she has friends, you don't know what she does all day, and you don't know your wife's blood type.
Just being a good guy, so everybody can see him being a good guy.
Well, you really don't like him, do you?
All I'm trying to do is be nice to the people who are volunteering to help find Amy.
I will practice believing my husband loves me, but I could be wrong.
You ever seen that guy in the glasses before?
Amy is the kind of girl who attracts admirers.
Whoever took her is bound to bring her back.
I'm hoping you can tell me what this means.
You want to solve Amy's treasure hunt?
You seen this girl around here?
Yeah, I remember her.
I know you. I saw you at the volunteer center.
I wanted to help.
What she want?
She wanted a gun.
We are all scared, but we are all here now.
I feel like something to be jettisoned if necessary. I feel like I could disappear.
The hallmark of a sociopath is a lack of empathy.
Amy lost a lot of blood in there. Then somebody mopped it up.
Why would they mop up the blood if they're trying to stage a crime scene?
Whatever they found, I think it's safe to assume that it's very bad.
I finally realized I am frightened of my own husband.
I would join you as if you're doing a deposition. What to say, what not to say.
A trained monkey?
A trained monkey who doesn't get lethal injections.
She's going to eat you alive.
You assaulted her?
It's not good enough for you?
I hit her?
It's not even close.
Absolutely not. I never touched her.
We now believe Nick is involved in the disappearance of our daughter.
Without a body, without a murder weapon, their only hope is a confession.
Y'all know anything yet?
You need to tell me.
How was your marriage, Nick?
Are you asking me if I killed my wife?
Man of my dreams. This man of mine may kill me.
What about my son,
Nick?
This man may kill me. In her own words, this man may truly kill me.
You ever hear the expression, the simplest answer is often the correct one?
Actually, I've never found that to be true.
Joining me now, David Fincher, the director, Gillian Flynn, the author and screenwriter, and two of the film stars, Ben Affleck and Rosamund Pike. I am pleased to have them here at this table. Welcome.
Thank you very much.
Explain the popularity of the book first.
Explain yourself.
Yes.
Why are you here now?
You know, I think it was the relationship that's at the heart of the story. You know, I think there are a lot of different kind of thrillers that, you know, that have a whodunit element. But I think it was one of those things, you know, women wanted to talk about it, men wanted to talk about it. People finished reading it and handed it on to someone else.
But because it's about relationships at the core.
I think at the core, there, you know, there's a lot of entry points to it. You know, there's gender stuff. There's the, you know, the media and what's that what that's doing to society. There's relationship stuff. There's a lot of ways into the book, ways to have opinions about it.
Tell me about the casting. I mean, you said that based on Ben's smile.
It's a little out of the. No, I never dreamed that he would be available because actually at the time that we were crewing up to make the movie, we were sort of jockeying to get a lot of the same grips and electricians and camera department people because he was directing. And it was obviously, I mean, everybody that was discussing at the studio was saying, oh, if only Ben Affleck was available, if only. And
why were they saying that?
Because it's just too perfect.
What does that mean?
I think that you need to have somebody who has great wit about the situations that this guy finds himself in. I mean, you don't want somebody who has, you know, he needed to be somebody who could understand the global aspect of the film, the impression that he's making over the course of the 2.5 hours, as opposed to, you know, finding yourself in a situation that's particularly embarrassing at any given moment.
Gillian, tell me how you saw Nick, because you've said this is the trickiest role.
Yeah, I mean, I think it's really, it's the role that the movie hinges on. There's so much subtlety to it. There's so many different nuances to it. But we can't really know that there are nuances being played. And so I had to have an actor, you know, like Ben, you know, I thought of him kind of immediately once I started writing the screenplay, because I kind of knew, you know, I loved films like Hollywoodland that he was in, like where you saw kind of that darker side. So I knew he had that great acting ability to pull off making us wonder what this guy was thinking without saying too much, and at the same time this real core likability, because you don't want the audience to turn completely off on him immediately.
Well, so what was the challenge for you here? Both of them thought you're
nice
the guy
to
for this.
Hear how perfect you are for a sort of morally suspect character.
Well, there was that
my moral bankrupt air, as it was put in some magazine. But no, the truth is, I think what was really interesting for me was I mean, yes, there's the things and I'm not the only actor who's been through tabloid experiences and has photographers, you know, outside their home and that sort of thing. But it's something that I've sort of made peace with. And there's a particular sort of quality to that experience in my life that is parallel in some ways to some of the arcs in the story.
So you had something to draw on there.
So, I didn't have to like spend a lot of time researching that.
But there was also no hindsight resentment of it. I mean, I think you were incredibly well balanced. Yeah, and got that this was, you don't have any say in it. It's not about you. It's beyond you. And I think that was the thing that the effortlessness that you were able to bring to it.
Yeah, I think what these guys put together was a really interesting challenge and a really interesting and unusual protagonist. It's not a conventional protagonist because it's somebody that Hollywood has this obsession with likability. Like if you read studio's notes, one of the first objections, the guy's not likable enough. We're not invested with him enough. And to make somebody likable, the theory goes, well, you have to like adhere to these six or seven, you know, articles of behavior.
Yes.
And this movie, this book and movie seem to totally want to abandon that. And so that what happens is that sometimes he makes choices that sometimes you can understand and empathize with, and then things start to happen. You go, whoa. You know, I'm not sure that I would do that exactly. And he's sometimes obtuse and sometimes astute. And what's interesting about that is that I think the audience is forced to project themselves onto a more honest protagonist, because that's who we really sort of, than one that is conveniently manufactured to, you know, sort of reassure us of our own virtue.
How did you know about this film?
No, that's a very good point, all those things. In this film, likability is not important, is it? Which is a big relief, I think, for all of us.
Is this a role you went after because you heard about the play?
I don't think you can't go after something when he's directing it. I mean, you can't,
right?
No.
He has to come to you.
A very singular process, which everybody... I mean, I think that's the point. I know enough about directors to sort of believe fundamentally that you can't really... You know, I don't think you can sort of pitch your wares to a director. Yeah. I don't think that's how it works. I mean, people try, sure. Mm. But the approach has to come.
That's an interesting idea. Is that true, you think, man? I mean, suppose there's someone who really has to convince somebody. Maybe at first instance, they don't think that you might be right. And you have to convince them because you think...
Of course.
And then you do convince them. And then they're happy that you did.
The temptation to do that is obviously very strong, but I don't know. How many times have you been convinced of something?
Yeah, I think you can make an impression. I don't know how David feels, but I think you're going to make an... It's appealing to see that somebody has a tremendous amount of commitment and is willing to, like, walk through fire, which Roz did. I mean, she did everything you could possibly do for this movie, and that was clear. And so, I mean, other than that, I think sometimes actors get into that.
In the movie, but are getting the part.
We're willing to go to any length to play the part. But, you know, there's also a thing actors do where, you know, they're playing, like, the war hero come, you know, heroin addict. You know, I actually was a heroin addict too. You know, you get a little bit. Yes. I've done it myself, you know, like starting out as an actor. I remember I had a TV show and we're like, can you play tennis? And I was like, yeah, I'm actually pretty good. And then it turned out the whole scene was like hitting tennis balls. And it was just like, it comes out, you know.
Lessons.
So there's a bullshitting thing that goes on. And that's why it's sort of hard to tell. But what is easy to see is commitment. And that's easy to see that. I imagine David saw it early on. You certainly saw it when she did the part.
But what he said... Go ahead.
Well, I feel that also... You know, I feel when David Fincher wants to meet you, your only responsibility is to try and, you know, show him a truth. You know, because he's not a guy who's going to take whatever's been packaged already. He's got his own very particular scanner, and when he talks to you, he's going to, you know, scan the substrata and find out who you really are. And you know, you just got to go in there with willingness to talk for hours and hours and hours and hours, and it's interesting. And yeah, I read this book and thought, well, I know I've got this in me somewhere, which is disturbing enough as it is. But
you mean you had Amy in you?
Yeah.
This is what you said about her.
Uh-oh.
I know exactly. You needed an only child. You needed an orchid, and you needed a hothouse flower.
Well, what I said was, when I met her, I had seen Rosamund's work. I'd seen a lot of it, and I'd seen it kind of parsed. You know, it would be like, I'd see a movie, and then 2 years later, I'd see another movie. And I'm one of those people who, you know, I watch actors all day long. That's all I do. And so I kind of, you know, you think you develop a radar for their, how many arrows they have in their quiver. And I never got a bead on Rosamund, which was something that was very different for me. So when we started talking about Rosamund, I was like, well, I don't have a full impression of her, which is weird because I've seen 4 movies that she's been in. And then I met her and I realized that there's a sort of opacity and there's a resistance to being pinned down. And as we started talking, I was drawn to her and curious about her, and we started talking about her upbringing. And she revealed that she was an only child, and it suddenly occurred to me that Amy is an only child who has a cartoon as a twin,
right.
And all of a sudden it made sense why I couldn't quite grasp her.
It's so like facts filling out your instincts.
Yeah, exactly. You go, I don't know, something's off here, something's different, something's special, and what is it? And then all of a sudden I realized.
What are we saying about marriage?
He's looking at me. Guilt. You know, I certainly started the story with that idea of, you know, how honest are we ever in relationships? You know, I like that idea that we are kind of emotional con artists when we start in on, in any sort of meeting, that we're presenting our best self forward. And I like that idea that, you know, this was, a murder mystery, but marriage was the mystery. You know, to solve the murder, you have to solve the marriage and figure out who these two people really were. And that idea, you know, especially in this very media saturated world, you know, how much are we ever really our true selves at all? And that's why I like that the idea of the media is almost the third character in this film.
Yeah, and this also pervades this idea of what are they thinking?
Yeah, exactly. What are, you know, what do you ever really know what the person's thinking? You know, just because they tell you what they're thinking, are they truth telling there?
This is a book that we all know the ending from reading the book. Does that bother you at all? I mean,
we all do.
Everybody's read the book, no?
Well, yes, exactly. Yeah.
But you have to create a mystery.
I mean, I think the reason movie studios buy hit books is because it's in this arena.
There's a title, first of all.
Yeah, but in this arena, it means more than 2-3 million people handed it to somebody and said, "You got to read this." So it has been wind tunnel tested in a way.
That this is a story that works.
Yeah.
But also we've made this film painstakingly over a long period of time, and it's not just about knowing what happens. I think there's so much more in it.
All that stuff is like, was it T.S. Eliot, I think, said that the, if you think of a playwright as trying to break into the mind of the audience, that the plot is basically just the sort of meat you throw the guard dogs to distract them while you get into the subconscious. And that's really what's, to me, what's going on here. You know, this plot, it's not that it's discarded, but that it occupies the conscious mind, the front brain, while underneath this very provocative question is asked, which is how much of marriage is lying? Which I think is sort of scary. I mean, everyone, you know, wants to think they have a good marriage and doesn't want to think of themselves as a liar, but by the same token, there's a sort of dance of how do I present myself and the question of at what point do I
reveal my truth. And so how quick do we find out in marriage that there's an element of lying?
I think it depends on your marriage.
I
think,
how long people are willing to play the game, because, you know, Gillian sets this couple up. So Gillian sets up this couple who sort of, for narcissistic reasons of their own, have slightly shifted their true selves to sort of slot in with who they'd like to be perceived to be by the other person.
The suggestion is that any couple could be this couple, that it could go this way, and that these tendencies are at the root of marriage, along with all of the love and the purity and that stuff. There's also this underbelly that could be potentially quite toxic.
Let me go back to casting because there's so many interesting people here. How did you approach that? Did each of them like Tyler Perry?
I had met Tyler in real life, and I just...
Plays a classic defense attorney.
Well, but in the book, I mean, he's much more of, you know, he's...
Showman. He's
he's a little more...
Razzle-dazzle.
He's also a little more cynical, you know, I think, in the book. He's much more of a... He's kind of a huckster. And what I love, as we were starting to sort of see the faces and have the pictures and kind of get a look at the team... You know, one of the things that I sort of felt was we'd have so little screen time with Tanner. Maybe he shouldn't be this guy who's totally smooth. Maybe he should be a guy who's totally honest and puts you at ease. And when you talk to Tanner Bolt, who is introduced as this shyster, you know, like, mm-hmm. you know, and you see him and he's like, you got to go take it on the chin. You got to walk out there and you got to take your lumps, and this is the best way to do it. Show contrition, and that's what is. And what I love is his voice and his manner. And as an actor, he watches everything so, you know, he's so wrapped in it. He watches everybody. And I thought that was something.
The nature of Tyler Perry.
Yeah, he's just, you know, it is that.
It's student always.
Yeah, he's the talk show host. He's like somebody who's going to sit you down and make you feel calm, and you're going to spill.
What does it tell us about, in the end, about media and how we, those of us who don't, I don't do a lot of that, but we all are obsessed by celebrity. And in fact, we bring a prism to it that's unreal.
Well, we're not talking about the media. We're talking about a very narrow spectrum, which is tragedy vampirism. Right. And that's a...
It's tragedy...
Vampirism.
Vampirism.
Yeah.
Is that a term you coined?
I've trademarked it, but no, I don't know any other way to describe it.
Grief-jacking.
Yeah, exactly. Grief-jacking. I like that better. Trademark that. It's when you see these programs that are designed to stoke your righteous indignation about what is such an obvious, you know, when it's 9 times out of 10 that it's the husband, and it's so obvious this is one of those 9 times, that's what we're talking about. We're talking about that rush to judgment. We're talking about the stoking of the lynch mob.
There's a certain profiteering that I think is unseemly, where and inserting of oneself into a story, and when it doesn't seem to be, you know, scandalous or prurient enough, you know, trying to dig around for more details. It's like, look, clearly someone murdered someone in their family. I mean, you know, it's appropriate to report on it. It's appropriate to, but then there come these like huckster lawyers who show up and want to sue somebody, and four more, you know, shows show up, and I think there's this sort of chicken and the egg thing where the people who are doing this, you know, semi-hysterical reportage around murder say, well, it's what the you know, we're giving people what they want. This is the demand is there for it, so we give them. But I think that's a sort of sophistry, not unlike, you know, what a crack dealer might say to you. You go, well, why are you doing this? Well, people want the crack. Well, if you weren't, they weren't all smoking it to begin with because you sold it to them.
Talk to somebody in Mexico. Why do you sell so many drugs? Because you Americans want them.
Yeah, exactly.
That's what they say.
Because there's a market.
Yeah. There's a market. You wrote characters... Two important characters, Nick and Amy. Was it easier for you to write one or the other? And part of that's a gender question, but Nick may be more interesting.
It was easier for me to write Nick. I mean,
because?
I'm Nick-like. There's a certain, you know, Nick I gave, you know, Nick has a lot of my biography. Yeah, we come from the same area. We, you know, both were
journalists,
pop culture obsessed and wrote about that. And, you know, I I have a very soft spot for everything that Nick gets himself into, because I'm sort of that sort of same way. Like, what's the easiest thing to do here is to, well, you know, I'll smile and see where this goes instead of actually fighting it, which I think is a lot of Nick's thing. And with, you know, with Amy, I spent a lot of time trying to figure out who Amy was. You know, I spent a lot of doing, you know, old-fashioned, like, college-level, you know, exercises, writing exercises, to try to figure out who Amy was. It took a little bit longer than that to, you know, that's why Amy has got such an elaborate backstory. You know, the parents weren't in there to begin with, but as I was trying to figure out who she was, I was like, it's got to go back to the childhood somewhere.
And what's the impact on her of the fact that, I mean, she hates it when she gets to the small town, or realizes she hates it, but what's the impact on her in terms of the development that she has this cartoon character sister?
Yeah, I mean, to me, that's kind of what I thought when I was realizing where I knew that I knew she came from money early on. I couldn't figure out what the family industry was. For a while, it was like a dating site, and I thought that, you know, that was too on the nose. It was kind of like this eHarmony marriage site, and then I thought,
we should have done that. Yeah. But whatever, keep going.
The DVD
Stop
extras,
everything.
We'll film it. You know, and then I just realized that idea of, first of all, this kind of unearned honor. You know, her parents are the one that created this famous alter ego for her. Right. She didn't do it. But at the same time, I liked the idea that it was always a little bit better than she was. So she was, you know, in constant, you know, sibling rivalry with this thing that didn't really exist. But, I mean, Rosamund, how did you get in? Did that feel right to you?
Yeah, I mean, you know, when you talked about celebrity earlier or whatever, I think that's the hardest thing, is when you're under the media spotlight for something you didn't earn through your own merits. Yeah. Which is what Amy's had from a tiny little girl. She's had to perform at these book functions.
So does she feel like a fake, or?
I think she doesn't know who she is. I think she's got a fragile sense of self because you've got this amazing Amy character who, you know, excels everywhere, at every point that the real Amy failed or gave up, you know, whether it's sport or music or academia or whatever. And yet she's meant to sort of go out there and parade herself as a sort of, you know, as the prototype. And I think it's meant her, maybe she's probably very sort of inward looking because of that, and also a sense of sort of entitlement coupled with inferiority or inadequacy, which makes a very unstable person. So you translate that little girl into an adult woman who's in New York on the dating scene, where there's freedom, as you say, in New York, to sort of keep reinventing yourself, perhaps not so if you do live in a small town, because your circle of friends can just shift. And she'll just be whoever she needs to be to get the best out of that situation, you know.
Let's talk about Mr. Fincher as a director.
Oh, jeez.
Is he different?
We don't talk about this much, but he...
Are you putting me on? This is awkward.
The studio felt as though they needed, I don't want to say ghost director, but somebody who could. A grown up on the set.
It's not that he's bad, Charlie. That's not what I'm saying. I got it.
Or helpless, or confused. Those are the wrong words.
But he needed somebody there when he had to make a hard decision.
A decision maker.
Exactly.
Not a ghost director, but made a lot of that decisions.
Let me see if I've got it now. On the set, he kind of is wishy-washy. He doesn't really know what he wants. Pretty much is willing to take the first thing he sees and go with it. Have I got it?
Yes.
Doesn't care much. Obviously David's got the whole, you know, everybody knows that David is. I think you're just by your work anyway. Like a lot of the behind the scenes anecdotes, I've seen like good directors and bad directors. It's hard to tell sometimes when you watch them work because stylistically people are different. But David's movies are, you know, speak for themselves, and they're excellent and great. And so that's the thing, as an actor, you show up and say like, I want to work with somebody who I can trust, because so often you lay yourself out there just as hard for a movie that works as one that doesn't, you know, like I was saying about what Roz did for just the physical aspect of getting banged against walls and thrown on the ground. David has yet to learn about stunt actors, actually. That's
Wait, that either. Wait. You mean it's a punishment to be with him?
No, it's that you put yourself out, you commit yourself, and you want it to be like, you want somebody to use the good stuff. You want someone to appreciate what you want. Someone smart to make a smart movie, and that's at its basis the appeal. And I liked when I first sat down with David. He was like, I don't know if you thought I thought I was going to be it was going to be Club Med or what or something, but he was like, look, it's not about the process for me. It's about like I want to do something. It's about the products, but what we do ultimately, how we express this. It's, in other words, the message is not going to be we're not going to be a party. We're not going to have fun. We're not doing this so we can, you know, like get free drinks after or something. You know what I mean? This is about making something that we can be be proud of. And I like that idea a lot, a lot more than just sort of like, yeah, we'll get a good caterer and that kind of stuff.
This is what he said about his many famous many takes. It's a lot of extra work for an actor, and sometimes it pushes them out of their comfort area in a zone. In some cases, they're not getting paid as much as they would on another movie. I go out on a limb, and people work harder for me than they do for other people. But I want them to be happy with the fact that we were able to do something singular, something unlike anything else in their or my filmography. That's well said.
It's very well said.
You know, that's what you were saying. That's exactly what you were saying.
David just wrote that, and it's true. It's exactly right. With I did some edits, but it's very
you did this
very
too?
Well done. I did.
He's, so not only did he want good. You to be a kind of assistant director, but a publicist for him.
Publicist, Charlie. That's how it works.
The sandwich. He gave you the sandwich.
Yeah. No, it's true. It's like, are we gonna like? You get to a certain point. You know, what matters is, am I? Is this gonna matter to me? Am I gonna be proud of this? And David is to. Praise him in front of him is awkward, but he's there at before anybody, and he's there after everyone's gone home. And I think that's a mark of a guy who's saying, look, we can succeed and we can fail. We can make good choices or bad choices, but I'm going to be as invested, if not more so, than anybody here. And that's actually not common among guys who have become really successful and kind of been around the block. And some directors tend to kind of go like, you know, yeah, I can prep the movie in 2 weeks. Yeah. And yeah, you know, I feel like this is pretty good. And David has, you know, more drive than a hungry director, never mind a guy who's like fat on the hog in Santa Barbara. You know?
He's fat on the hog in Santa Barbara?
No, then the guys who are fat. Oh, yeah, he's fat on the hog in Los Feliz.
Yeah, okay, well.
It's just about time. I mean, in any skilled or creative endeavor, the more time you're given, the better results you're going to get, generally. Yeah. And you know, David will spend his budget mainly on time, not on sort of, exactly. You know, a huge crew that's going to sort of, I mean, you know, that's where the money on screen. We'd shoot maybe 5 hours of footage a day. That's a lot of time on camera, especially, you know, which is a luxury. I mean, the most easiest way to make an actor screw something up is to say, we've got to get this in 20 minutes.
Yeah.
And then they're going to bring all their it's going to hit the fan and the
paint. But it is indicative of a priority. It's a zero-sum game. You have a certain amount of money and time, and how do you spend that? And then this movie, anyway, and I think in David's other movies, it's spent in front of the camera shooting. And for an actor, you have two options. You could be making the movie, doing what's interesting, trying different things, or you could be sitting in your trailer, which is incredibly boring and frustrating because you're not there to do what you want to do.
And
with him, by far, the ratio of time shooting to getting is higher than I've ever seen, and it's really rewarding. And the day goes by to 14 hours, you're like, or 12 hours or whatever, and it feels like nothing.
Do you try to pick actors who you know have that philosophy that you have? I mean, do you somehow know that that's kind of
I think it's your job to sort of inspire people to well, I think, look, I agree. I think actors want to act. I don't think they want to spend time, you know, on Twitter. I think that they want to, like, actually show up and do and have bites at the apple.
Yeah.
You know, I have a lot of friends who are actors who do live theater, and I go to visit them, and I go backstage to see them, and they say, oh, God, you should have come on Tuesday. That was the one. And you go, what? You don't want to do that with a movie. You know, with a movie, you want to go,
you want it to be too.
Yeah, here it is on Blu-ray. And by the way, this is all the best stuff. This is just literally, there's actually some good stuff that isn't in here, but this is the best. Yeah. And that's what I'm trying
to
do.
All the questions that honestly come with all these interviews about how many takes, it just makes me think, you know, the far more interesting questions to people who don't do multiple takes is why do you only do two or three?
Why did you know you could make it better?
You know, isn't
it? Why gather all these people all this money and the trucks and the drivers and the sets and the thing and then go like, look, that seemed good enough. I don't know. You guys want a head? You know, pretty good.
Let's go to the casino.
Yeah, exactly.
Where are Nick and Amy in 10 years?
Nowhere good. Nowhere good. You know, I love the people have asked me, you know, oh, when's the sequel coming? You know, I certainly did not set out to write anything that was going to go on. You know, I ended the book the way I ended it, though, because I like those open-ended. I like that sense of kind of unease that you have. And
you didn't want it neatly tied together.
I didn't want it neatly tied together. Absolutely not. And, you know, certainly I knew that was not always going to be the most satisfying ending for some people, especially for people who have been kind of trained that, you know, and here comes the movie and here's the explosion or the gunshot
the
or
justice.
Comes the justice.
Here's the rabbit.
Yeah.
Could you find the justice in this?
Yeah. Well, I mean, people tell me all the time that people will wait 30 minutes in line to get their book signed by me and slam it down in front of me and say, I hated the ending. Yeah. And I say, you know, well, what did you want to happen? I wanted justice. I said, what about this story ever made you believe there was going to be justice?
Yeah. What about these characters?
What about life?
What about love?
Yeah, exactly.
What about love?
What about love? Where does justice...
There's no justice in love.
I don't think so.
So when you think about 5 to 10 years, are you now intrigued by the idea of coming back to these characters?
Certainly not for a while. I've had a fair amount of Nick and Amy, but, you know, I've been in their brains for too long.
Yeah.
But, you know, I'd like to see, you know, when the teen years come around.
You're intrigued by this, aren't you?
I think what's interesting about that question is that the paradigm shift would be, not that this is like saying you should be a sequel, whatever, but just the idea of it is, that the whole thing changes because there would be a child. You'd have a kid. They'd be raising the kid.
Exactly.
And so the center of gravity is not Nick or Amy or Nick and Amy or their whole, shtick together. It's like, how are they affecting the life of this child? It's a big reason why Nick ends up, or what he says, he ends up staying. It's like, now my responsibility is to this child, and my own needs have to be completely subverted. And I often admire people, actually, who I know who have made choices like that, who said, like, this is a... It's a consequence of some choices I made in love, but now here I am, this child's here, and I'm going to invest in it at the expense of a lot of other stuff I'd rather be doing. And that's half of what Nick says. And I think that's interesting and much more tragic than a bad marriage is the, like, horrible baggage, you know, that can be passed on to children.
To children.
Well, and as everyone knows, you know, who to do the whole classic have the baby to save the marriage thing, the children only expose any cracks and fissures that are already there. So I think, you know, seeing what that brings out in Nick and Amy as they each try to mold or protect the child could be sort of fascinating.
You're intrigued by what happens to Amy?
As a mother, yeah. I am intrigued, yes. I mean, your brain continues with the characters long after you finish shooting the movie, so... But I need to have Gillian's brain to really figure it out.
What was the hardest thing about Nick for you?
The hardest thing was definitely, like, when I first sat down with David, he said, you know, look, we have to just let go of any vanity, any of the actory stuff, any pretense to, you know, self-consciousness and worrying about people will think. And there's parts of...
Meaning being a mean character?
Doing things that people judge. Like, you can read things and go, well, this guy Nick, he's a jerk. Like, a lot of journalists say that. And you have to understand, I've done enough movies to know, and I have enough friends who are actors to know, that audiences conflate people with the characters they play. So there's a vulnerability there to go, like, because, you know, I know people who are not great people, but who are thought of as great people because they play great characters and vice versa. I've been in situations where people have sort of made judgments about me based on the characters that I played. And so there's a raw kind of first level of soil that says, like, oh, we're going to do that, I'm going to do that, but that looks like horrible, you know?
Well, it's not even the notion of did he or didn't he, and has he done something evil. It's also, he does things that are very human that are like, oh, why?
Right.
And that's a really, it's a hard thing. Audiences go out of their way, and I think actors go out of their way, you know, to be in a situation where you can avoid that. You've agreed on what the text is. You've rehearsed the thing. You've taken, you know, hopefully the stumble and fall out of the equation. This is a character who, you know, steps on a rake and gets hit in the forehead.
Yeah.
I mean, it continually does that.
But did your idea, Nick, believe that he could come back in terms of recapturing the life that he had?
I think this was a guy who was sort of felt like he was operating from behind the whole time. You know, he reminded me of, you know, those rats that you see in glass cages who keep on scrabbling, think they can get up, but you know what I mean? But they're just sitting there going like this. And there was a lot of that.
That was your idea, Nick. That's
part of it. And he kept on doing things wrong and spending time going, how am I going to fix the last thing that happened? Yeah. And making that stuff feel like, because I think that's us. We're constantly shooting ourselves in the foot in ways that we try to pretend we don't, which when we present our best selves and we say our lines right and don't step on the furniture. And I wanted to... you know, I believe that he was a guy who was kind of playing catch up, and it took the support of his sister and this sort of wonderfully, like, sort of magically, almost deus ex machina, Tyler Perry, to come down and say, like, you've made many mistakes. And now we're going to try to salvage what we can. Right. And, you know, sometimes in life we need someone to go, and then he feels like, okay, I can do this. And he starts to take control of his life. And what I think is interesting is that he does have these kind of Midwestern values that she talks about, of like good manners and earnestness and friendliness and honesty. And every one of those gets him in trouble. And he doesn't become successful until he abandons all that stuff and starts to be like, okay, I'll become manipulative. And, you know, like cagey and slightly disingenuous in terms of how I, you know, plan how I come off in the media and that stuff. I kind of thought that was a bold.
And he's good at it when he does it. He's good at it. You know, towards the last section of the movie, we move into this very, very surreal place where we're sort of, we're satirizing so much, and yet it's sort of, it's the point that you feel a palpable shift in the audience as they start to kind of see these two players playing each other in a totally different way. And I just love, I love the idea that Amy has kind of, for her purposes, has reignited the Nick that she first saw.
Oh, yeah.
You know, he is now performing. He is now, you know, reflecting. He is now, in her narcissistic mind, sort of worthy of her, because he's not, you know, the schlub in his boxers playing video games. He's back to presenting a public facade, to performing, to playing the husband incredible.
You know, I've never been part of a movie, I can't even think of a movie really, that has genuinely changed tones during the course of the movie. Beginning, it's very realistic, matter of fact, wife's blood type, interrogated by the police, and you look at me, and yeah, she's holding me sort of hostage by, you know, in the shower, and there's blood, and the whole thing is like, she's killed, I mean, the whole thing has mushroomed into something totally different that to me is sort of segued from realism into using a kind of broader brush to allow these themes to emerge in a really rich way. And I don't, it's done, it's why I never thought it'd be possible to make this movie. I had no idea how you would do it. And it's a really interesting trick that David and Gillian pulled off.
Thank you. It's incredible. It really is. Thank you, David. Thank you. Remarkable. Thank you. We go out with this scene where Nick asks Amy at a party. Here it is.
Amy, who are you?
A, I'm an award-winning scrimshander. B, I'm a moderately influential warlord. C, I write personality quizzes for magazines.
Okay. Well, your hands are far too delicate for real scrimshaw work. And I happen to be a charter subscriber to Middling Warlord Weekly, so I'd recognize you. I'm gonna go with C.
And you? Who are you?
I'm the guy to save you from all this awesomeness.